The IIST Experimental Lakes Area is a natural laboratory of 58 lakes in northeastern Ontario, Canada, where the research program centers on understanding the effects of environmental change and on developing lake management and remediation strategies. Beginning in 1969, whole lake experiments have been conducted to identify the factors causing harmful algal blooms. These results showed how nutrient enrichment can lead to noxious blooms of cyanobacteria and the overriding importance of phosphorus as a limiting factor for biomass production. These visually compelling observations, along with the limnological data, underscored the importance of reducing external phosphorus loading as the key management strategy for control of eutrophication. Phosphorus is a controlling factor because it is often in low supply relative to algal demand, and it plays a major role in all cells, notably in nucleic acids, DNA and RNA, and in membrane phospholipids. Phosphorus occurs in a great variety of forms in lakes and rivers, within particles as well as dissolved forms. For limnological analyses, it is typically measured in unfiltered water as the combination of particulate and dissolved phosphorus. These total phosphorus, TP values, range from less than 5 micrograms per liter in very unproductive waters to greater than 100 micrograms per liter in highly eutrophic waters. In oligotrophic lakes, the concentrations of total and soluble phosphorus exhibit little variation with increasing depth. But eutrophic lakes with strongly clinograde oxygen profiles commonly show a pronounced increase in phosphorus content in the lower hypolimnium. Total dissolved phosphorus, TDP, or soluble phosphorus, is typically measured as the total P concentration in water that has been filtered to remove most of the particles. The most biologically available fraction of TDP is orthophosphate, and is analyzed as soluble reactive phosphorus, which may also include polyphosphates and small organic phosphorus molecules. Dissolved organic phosphorus, DOP, comprises soluble organic molecules of diverse molecular weights and variable availability to the plankton. Dissolved phosphorus in rivers is generally higher than in lakes, and often increases markedly following rainfall and snowmelt events in the drainage basin. At low concentrations in streams, phosphorus can be limiting, and microbial productivity often increases with increased phosphorus loading. A key part of the phosphorus cycle that has major implications for theoretical as well as applied limnology is the set of biogeochemical processes that take place across the sediment-water interface at the bottom of lakes and rivers. Dr. Raoul Couture directs the Aquatic Geochemistry Group in the Department of Chemistry and Centre for Northern Studies at Université Laval in Quebec City, Canada. In his research, he combines field observations, experiments, and modelling to understand the biogeochemical response of aquatic ecosystems to environmental change. And he has a special interest in the fate and transport of redox-sensitive elements, including across the sediment-water interface. Here he describes the classic experiments on sediment-phosphorus chemistry and new perspectives from current research.
Sediment-water interactions are governed by oxygen supply, mineral solubility, sorption mechanisms, microbial activities, and transport processes. Deep within sediments, vertical exchanges occur primarily through slow molecular diffusion. However, at the sediment-water interface, more rapid physical and biological processes will influence material transport across the boundary layer. The sediments receive continuous inputs of phosphorus by particles that sink down from the water column. These include algae, detritus, and mineral particles. Within sediments, phosphorus transfers from particulate to dissolved phase in all waters through desorption, dissolution, ligand exchange, and microbial processes. A striking effect in some, but not all, sediments is the release of dissolved phosphorus into the overlying water column when the sediments become anoxic. This is an effect that was first observed in the classic experiment by Clifford Mortimer, in which sediments and water from Lake Windermere in the English Lake District were put in two aquarium tanks. One was aerated continuously and the other without aeration, beginning at around 10 weeks in the non-oxygenated tank. When the redox potential fell below 200 millivolts, there was a release of iron and manganese from the sediments into the overlying water and an increasing release of phosphate. These effects were not observed in the oxygenated treatment. These observations are interpreted as the conversion of insoluble ferric iron or iron 3 oxyhydroxides and phosphate complexes to soluble ferrous iron or iron 2, which forms under reducing conditions. This process is known as reductive dissolution, and it releases previously bound and adsorbed phosphate into the water. It is now well known that various microbial processes can modulate and amplify the phosphate release from sediments under anaerobic conditions. However, this effect is not universal. In colored lakes, such as in the boreal zone, the high concentrations of humic materials enhance the binding of phosphorus in sediments and could prevent its release even under anoxic conditions.
Up in the water column, the exchange of phosphorus between its various forms is often rapid and involves numerous complex pathways. A large portion, often more than 95%, is bound in the particulate phase of living biota, especially bacteria, algae, and other microbes, as well as with non-living particles. These different pools of phosphorus are recycled at different turnover rates. Turnover of the phosphate pool can be especially rapid, minutes, during summer periods of high plankton demand and low pea loading inputs. The external loading of phosphorus to lakes varies with factors such as patterns of land use, geology of the drainage basin, soil productivity, and pollution. When phosphorus is added to unproductive fresh waters, either experimentally or as a result of human activities, the usual response is a rapid increase in phytoplankton biomass and productivity. In the classic experiment by David Schindler at the Experimental Lakes Area, now the IISD-ELA, Lake 226 was subdivided in two with an impermeable curtain. Enrichment of the southwest basin with carbon and nitrogen produced no effect, while CNN plus P addition to the northeast basin caused a pronounced increase in phytoplankton biomass and turbidity, and a striking decrease in water clarity, as measured by the secchi depth. The phytoplankton was dominated by bloom-forming cyanobacteria, and in general, this group of noxious algae is stimulated by increasing total phosphorus levels. Recovery of the lake to near pre-fertilization levels was rapid when phosphate additions were discontinued, supporting the need to reduce pea loading to control eutrophication. Statistical and numerical models can be used to estimate the permissible phosphorus loading needed to achieve a certain level of in-lake total phosphorus and thus algal biomass if the loading is lowered. However, the sediment release of phosphorus, that is internal loading, may contribute towards a hysteresis effect and a delay in recovery. In many parts of the world, lake and river management strategies are now targeting nitrogen load reductions in addition to phosphorus control. An example is here at Lake Rotorua on the central North Island of New Zealand, which has naturally high phosphorus inputs from its volcanic soils. Control of N pollution may also reduce the extent of oxygen depletion by ammonium oxidizing bacteria, nitrifiers, as well as lessen the transport of nitrogen to the coastal ocean, where marine algal blooms can be stimulated by nitrogen enrichment. An additional consideration for N plus P reductions is that certain toxins produced by bloom-forming cyanobacteria contain nitrogen. Control of pea loading may limit the biomass concentrations of these noxious species, while additional control of end loading may further reduce their growth and also toxicity. The impacts of climate change on phosphorus dynamics are not yet well understood. Climate-related changes, for example, in precipitation, storm intensity, floods, and droughts, all have the potential to affect phosphorus export rates from catchments and lake phosphorus dynamics. Many of these effects, however, may be difficult to distinguish from those caused by other human activities, such as changes in land use, agricultural practices, and wastewater discharge. This combination of changes and their impacts on the world's fresh waters underscores the need for international collaboration to reduce these perturbations of the global phosphorus cycle. One such initiative is the Jeff UNEP project Upcycle, executed by the UK Centre for Ecology and Hydrology. Dr. Will Brownlee is an environmental scientist at the centre and is project manager of Upcycle. Dr. Brownlee has a special interest in sustainable phosphorus management for lake and river ecosystems, and his work involves multi-stakeholder engagement to develop scientific understanding and to provide expert advice in support of sustainable nutrient use. Here he describes the challenge of restoring lakes that have passed a tipping point of phosphorus pollution. That is, a lake's sudden transition from clear waters with macrophytes to turbid waters with noxious algal blooms.
Now, to try and return it to that state of a healthy system with clear water and lots of diversity in your ecosystem is not as simple as just going back to the phosphorus concentration that happened just before the tipping point. It's a phenomenon we call hysteresis, and it actually means that the path to an algal bloom is not the same as the path to a healthy state. It's actually going to take much more energy, much more actions, more significant actions. So the Upcycle project responds to that need by going in and identifying the problems. And we're working out tools, reports, and support guidance documents on how do you identify your sources of pollution within your catchment. We then provide a list of solutions, a method and a process to be able to go into your lake in your catchment, if you're a policy maker or an environment manager or in charge of looking after your lake, and to be able to follow a stepwise process for dealing with your phosphorus pollution from land and then maintaining the quality of your lake or restoring your lake if it's already beyond that tipping point. And we're actually taking those two parts of the project, the process of identifying the problems and finding the solutions, and we're running that in Chile, in Lake Villarrica, and the Ministry of Environment are actually following the project and working with us to really test that theory and that process.
An additional aim of the Upcycle program is to identify ways in which phosphorus can be recovered and subsequently reused, for example, from waste streams and in agricultural practices. This upcycling concept in general, that is the repurposing and reuse of waste, is now an intense focus of research in environmental engineering and biotechnology, and a globally important part of the overall strategy towards sustainable management of the world's freshwaters and their associated catchments.